All right, good morning. I'm Phil, the evangelist here in the church, Phil Gabbard, and it's a great privilege to be a part of this service today. I'm glad that you're here. And generally my job here around the church is to teach the Bible and then also to preach when there's an opportunity or I'm asked by Pastor Holt, Pastor Jeremiah. But I'm going to be in the book of 2 Timothy. In 2 Timothy this morning, this would be what I would normally teach here at Hope on Sunday morning for the adult Sunday school class. In 2 Timothy, the Bible says this, Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Now, when I look at this, verse 1, it says, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. That word grace is a cornerstone word for any Bible-believing Christian. For that word grace, defined as used in the King James Bible, is a gift from the Heavenly Father given through His Son, Jesus Christ. That's a dictionary definition for the word grace. The word grace, as used in the scriptures, refers primarily to enabling power and spiritual healing offered through the mercy and love of Jesus Christ our Lord. No one can return to the presence of God without divine grace. And I use that word divine because it's a specific kind of grace. It's the grace that comes from God, from the Word of God, and from the Spirit of God, from the very throne of God itself. Now, I said 2 Timothy chapter 1. If I said that, I meant 2 Timothy chapter 2, 1 down through verse 3, if I get my pages turned right here. So there's always been around the acrostic for the word grace. In other words, the letters spelled out, G-R-A-C-E. And if you would put an acrostic to that, it'd be God's riches at Christ's expense. So what Christ did for us at Calvary has opened the door to the faith and the grace that we receive from God. So when Timothy says, or when Paul says to Timothy, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, he's definitely specifying what kind of grace he wants him. And that's God's grace. Not the grace of our great nation, not the grace of our family, loved ones, not those kinds of graces, but a godly, founded on godliness and the things of God, that kind of grace. So grace is different than mercy. A lot of times folks say, well, what's the difference between mercy and grace? Grace as such is a participation in God's own life. In other words, by giving us sanctifying grace, and there's a legal term, a spiritual, if I should say, legal in the mind of God, in the Word of God, sanctifying grace. He is actually imparting some of His own life to us. Now, that's grace, kind of defined in biblical terminologies. But now mercy also comes from God. When you talk of God's mercy, you think of a judging God. Mercy, on the other hand, is the loving kindness, compassion, or forbearance shown to one who offends, as in the mercy of God to us sinners. So just the fact that we're a sinner, born into this world, we're against God, not knowingly, not willingly, but born to that capacity. And it doesn't take long living life that you understand we have a propensity to sin, to cheat, to steal, to lie. And we might wonder, well, why am I so prone to do those things? It's because you're born without the Spirit of God in you. That Spirit departed over in the garden from Adam and Eve. So man has his body, his flesh, and his own spirit, minus the Spirit which would complete him, minus his spirit, the Spirit of God. So, but God had mercy. Says man may deserve the penalty that comes as a product of being a sinner, but I'm going to make a way for him. And therefore, his mercy shows long suffering. His mercy to usward is a great attribute to one of the character traits of the Heavenly Father. And so between Jesus Christ dying on the cross, expanding the boundaries of grace that it might appeal to all mankind, God's mercy allowed that grace. So the difference between mercy and grace, mercy speaks more to the wrath of God and his long-suffering and gentleness toward us and his goodness, that we don't get what we deserve. Where the grace of God surpasses the boundaries of our fallen nature, and once we realize our plight and our need, by grace we come to God. By grace are we saved through faith. So thank God for the grace of God and the mercy of God. In these days, we truly need the grace of God. And I believe even the mercy of God. I believe in our great nation, there are many people today that do not know God, but they're experiencing the mercy of God. Because I believe God, as a whole, over the years and decades, has blessed the United States of America. Those folks that know Christ in a free pardon of sin have also experienced the saving grace of God. Now back to our text, he told Timothy to be strong in the grace. Now, grace, strong in grace, implies that one could be weak in grace. So to grow in grace day by day is a part of the Christian life. The very fact that Paul said be strong in the grace of God lends itself to the thought that everybody is probably not as strong in the grace of God as they should be. Oh, I'm not saying they're not saved. They're saved by grace. And like the book of Jude says, they're saved as though pulling them out of the fire. I mean, just barely saved by the grace of God. Saved like a child gets saved, but never growing in the grace that can make you strong and to stand firm in these times. So our lesson today maybe could be titled Growing or Strengthening Oneself in the Grace of God. It's definitely to the Christian people, and if you're not saved, obviously, you need to be saved by grace through faith, as Paul teaches in another place. But in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 21, it says, in whom all the building, and he's speaking here, of the body of Christ, those that are saved by the grace of God, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord. There's a growing process, and it takes the grace of God to grow thereby. Hence Paul said, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. So it is our obligation as ministers and preachers, teachers, evangelists, and our missionaries to teach, and if you please, to edify the body of Christ. And this, in essence, is what the lesson is about today, that we might grow in grace. Now, stop there for a minute, and we would say, well, how can I grow? How can I become strong in the grace of God? Simply by listening to the Word of God and believing what God said. A lot of times it's what level of belief are we on when it comes to the things of God? Do we rather believe men? Do we rather believe the educational systems of the world? Do we rather believe a religious leader someplace steeped in his religion and ideologies and dogmas? Or would we rather believe the infallible Word of God and what it says? The Bible simply says that a man grows in faith by the Word of God. And faith and grace are hooked together. We'll share a verse or two in a minute. But it's impossible to grow in grace without strengthening oneself in the faith of the Word of God and in faith of the things of God. So this morning, Ephesians says, in whom all the building, speaking of the church, not the physical structure, but the membership or the body of believers that make up the body of Christ in the spiritual sense, and in all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord. So it's a growing process in the Lord, just like becoming strong in grace. It's part of it. So Ephesians, Paul writes again to the Ephesian people in Ephesians 4 and verse 15. And it's our part as ministers, our part as pastors, preachers, evangelists, teachers, to do what he says here for the Ephesian people. He says, but speaking the truth in love, that's Ephesians 4, 15. Speaking the truth in love, he says, may grow up into him in all things. When we speak the truth in love, that be the word of God, the words of God, they're pure words, they're truth. When we speak about the things of the Lord Jesus Christ, he is the way, the truth, and the life, then it's these things that cause the child of God to grow and become strong in the Lord Jesus Christ, hence to grow in grace. So here this morning, he says that they may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. So we're to learn from the Word of God that the reason we teach the scriptures verse by verse and compare scripture with scriptures is to know and to find out if these things be true, and they are. The Bible's not a contradictory book. It's a blessed book. It's a supernatural book, and a lot of folks struggle with understanding the very words of God, but it's written in such a manner that if you have a believing spirit and a teachable spirit, then you can grow in grace as God intended you to. You can become strong in the Lord Jesus Christ. And let's face it, we live in a time when it takes strong belief to stand firm, when it takes being strong in the faith and strong in the grace of God to take a stand in these last days. So from the Word of God, I really like Peter. When Peter gets involved, you can go to his writing in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. He was an authority on the grace of God, faith in the Lord. He says this to young Christians, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. He knew there was a growing process. When a person gets saved, they don't know the things of God. They don't know the Word of God. That's not unusual. That's expectant. And we understand that. And I'm a 70-year-old man, teaching the word of God. I didn't know these things when I was 12 years old, the days I got saved in 1962. I was 12 years old. I didn't know these things that I know today. You say, well, what happened? How did you find these things out? I found them out through the teachers of the Word of God and the preachers of the Word of God that taught the Word of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ. They taught in love and truth. And that's simply all that we are doing here at Hope Baptist Church when we teach the Word of God. Peter also said this in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, but grow in grace. That's right on point. Peter knew, and he's consistently bonding with the words of Paul. He says, grow in grace and in the knowledge. So there's a learning process of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I like what he puts, what the Lord allows him to put here. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So Peter understood when you get saved, you begin to learn and you begin to grow in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe as a minister and a preacher for many years now that one of the problems with Christianity is people sometimes can get saved, because I'm telling you, getting saved is a very simple process. Once you realize you're a sinner, you understand you do have the propensity to sin, and there's a reason for that. It's because you're a sinner and you don't have the Spirit of God and you need to be saved. And so upon accepting the Lord Jesus Christ and what he did at Calvary, you become a new creature. The Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost of God, moves in and he knits himself with that old broken spirit of man, and you become one spirit with God. That hence is the new birth. It's a spiritual birth, as he taught Nicodemus in John chapter 3. So here, there's a growing curve when you get saved, and I think people get saved. They get saved as children, as I did. But if I hadn't have been in church and hadn't have got around other Bible teachers and Bible preachers, then I could become an old man and not know anything about the grace of God, not know anything about the knowledge of God, and not know anything about the wisdom of God. You see, God called pastors and preachers and evangelists for the edifying of the body of Christ. And he says in another place that we, the pastors and teachers and preachers, ought to be apt to teach the Word of God. You say, why would we want to teach anything? Let's just tell stories and have a big time. And God, no, we need the doctrines of the Word of God, which yield themselves to the spiritual growth that is so necessary in the children of God. Do you realize that these things that we're going through at this time in our nation, this pandemic thing, could cause Christians to lend their spiritual ear to the things of God? You realize that as I stand here today, there's more people listening to the live stream than ever came to church before. Say, why? Because people are tuned in and they want to know, what does God say about this? And we want to do our part as teachers and preachers and evangelists. We want to inform the hearing public as to how good God is, and he's still on the throne, and God is not affected by our national worldly pandemics. He already died for the sin of the whole world. He's totally in control today, and you can trust him to guide you through these times. That's the teaching of the goodness of God, the things that should strengthen your grace and strengthen your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So the strong in the Lord should help the weaker brother or sister in the Lord. Paul was so emphatic to tell Timothy in chapter 2 of 2 Timothy, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, because he needed to teach all those people in Ephesus and different places that he went to preach the word of God. Said if you're not strong in the grace of God, you'll not be able to teach others how to be strong in the grace of God. So I learned from this lesson, the strong in the Lord. And nobody, could I clarify this? Nobody is as strong as they could be. And we teachers and preachers and older folks in the Lord are always striving to walk a better walk with the Lord Jesus Christ, to be ever growing in the grace and love and faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. But I am mindful of this. The strong in the Lord should help the weaker brother or sister in the Lord. That's always been the pattern in the Word of God. Paul said this to the Roman people in Romans chapter 15 at verse 1. We then that are strong, there we go, ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. Now he put that little last couple words in there, and we'll talk about them in just a moment. But notice in Romans 15, 1, when we then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. And the weak there are not those people in the world that are perishing so much, as the context here was to the church and to the believing brothers and sisters in Christ. And when someone gets saved, their troubles don't automatically all go away. Literally, they still could be addicted to something. They could be living through, if you please, a living hell from what life and sin and the devil has dealt them. They may not see clearly that the biggest problem they had was dying in their sins and going to hell. They don't clearly see that their biggest problem has already been taken care of. And so there's a void there. What the world used to give them, what sin used to give them, what carnality and filth and all the other things that the world gets entangled in used to fulfill in their life, or they thought was fulfilling, is now a void. And if it's not filled by the things of God, they will not grow spiritually, they will not grow in grace, they will not, and pretty soon they won't even come to church. It's one of the plagues and plights of our Christianity today. Everywhere you go, you'll hear church leaders say, it's so hard to get our new converts to come back to church. It's so hard when they get saved to see them come out of the world and get new friends and then try to win. They're not even able to win their old friends. They go back to their old evil communications. And the Bible does teach us that evil communications corrupt good manners. So if a person gets saved and goes right back to doing what they always did, doesn't come to church, doesn't get in the Bible, doesn't care about God anymore, then my friend, he will not grow and become strong in grace, faith, or in his spiritual walk. So here, when they that are strong ought to bear the infirmities, we then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. Part of our job as preachers, part of our job as teachers and evangelists, missionaries, is to teach those weaker Christians about Christ and teach the love of God in truth and love. The Word of God in love and truth is what we earlier read. The book of Matthew, and this principle goes throughout the Word of God. Matthew 26, verse 41. Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. That's good for anybody in the Christian walk. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Now I told you in Romans 15, 1, there were three or four words at the last part of verse 1, and not to please ourselves. And today a person gets saved and they start thinking about the old pleasures they used to enjoy. And they think, well, maybe I'll just say no to church this Sunday and no to church, and I won't get into the Sunday school class, and I won't get into the preaching hour. I'll just go do what I used to do and find enjoyment in those things. And I got news for you. That person is on a slippery slope to destroying his spiritual walk with God, because he's pleasing himself with the old things of the world. So when I look at that, watch and pray. The admonition is when a person gets saved, you ought to be watching for the things of God and praying about, watch and pray, that ye enter not into temptation. Temptation is on every hand. It's not a sin to be tempted, but it's there. Because this world, the songwriter said it best, is not my home. I'm just a passing through. But if you take up residency and become a part of this world's philosophy and all the things that it does and its pleasures, if you please, then I have news for you. You will not grow strong in the grace of God. You'll be weak in spiritual things. So with being weak in spiritual things, there'll be no harmony from you with those that walk in the light. Say, why? Because they're walking so far off. Could I remind you that when Peter denied the Lord, and he's an authority on these things, when he denied the Lord, he walked afar off, the Bible says. He was not in fellowship with God, and he was not in fellowship with his other brothers and apostles in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was out there with the enemy. He was out there with the majority that is lost and says, oh, it don't make any difference anyway. And those days were dark days for Peter. Thank God that he repented, got right, didn't stay backslid all of his life, and got on fire for God. Matthew says, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The Spirit indeed is willing. That's the Spirit of God. The Spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Let me remind you, everybody still lives in a body of flesh. And that body of flesh didn't get saved. That's why you're going to get a new body one of these days. That's why it keeps getting old and wrinkled, and it's going to die from one of the diseases of the world one of these days. But you'll get a new body, thank God. But here, and weak in the flesh is weak. Yeah, the flesh, it wants to do all the carnal things it always did. And if you allow it to do those things, you will not grow in the grace of God. They cancel one another out. Paul said this to the Romans in chapter 14 and verse 1. Him that is weak in the faith, receive you. Receive ye. You know, we want folks to come. We don't care what it is, but the first step in growing is coming to where you can be fed the spiritual things of God. So he says, him that is weak in the flesh, receive ye. And we receive. You'll hear us say, we don't care what you look like. We don't care who you are. We don't care what walk of life you've been walking in or where you're at. Come on. That's what the church is about. We're here to tell you about the spiritual things that can fortify your soul, the spiritual things that can save you from a devil's hell. Come and hear the word of God. But he says, him that is weak in the faith, receive ye. I know some folks, they say, we don't want those folks to come. Well, he said something about that. He says, but not to doubtful disputations. In other words, let them come as they are. Let them come. If you can't help them, listen, this is what God designed. This is how he set it up. There's not going to be any divine intervention from the skies of God. He's chosen the foolishness of preaching to save those that would believe. And so you got to come and hear. Get out and hear the word of God. But not to doubtful disputations. So we ministers, I'm not to argue with folks that come in. I'm not to cause conflict and argue with them and dispute them. He's not talking about doctrinal things here. He's talking about helping somebody out in a spiritual sense. He wants you to grow up in the Lord Jesus Christ. He told the Corinthian people, and we know that Corinth was a carnal church. In 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 12, but when ye sin, So against the brethren, and wound their weak conscience, ye sin against Christ. So spiritual leaders and teachers and preachers and pastors, we have to be careful that our liberty, if we should take one, would cause someone else to stumble and cause them to be defeated in their Christian life. And surely we don't want to do that. We want to teach in truth and love that the grace of God may abound. So here when Paul teaches to the Corinthian people, but when ye sin so against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, ye sin against Christ. The context there is they were taking liberties, those saved folks, taking liberties that possibly they should have been taking because it was causing the weaker brothers in the Lord to stumble. And what I want to point up here mainly is there are different levels, if you please, in the Christian life. And everybody is not walking a high spiritual plane, if you know what I'm saying. And so we that try to live closer to God, and surely the minister should, the pastor should, the deacon should, the evangelist should, the teacher should, any preacher should try to walk and live a spiritual life and do not condone sin in his life, because if he does and some weak brother sees it, what's going to happen? That weak brother is going to say, well, that's just a bunch of hypocrites down at the church. A lot of truth in that. So we have to be careful. And he says to the Corinthian people along these same lines in 1 Corinthians 11, 28, 30, but let a man examine himself. That would be good for every child of God, every person that's saved, to examine themselves. And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. Now, I know it's in reference to the Lord's Supper, but in reference to the things of God and growing in grace, there's a spiritual principle and a spiritual application to be made here. If we want to grow in grace, then we'll have to, if you please, spiritually eat and drink the things of God. So the implication in verse 29, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. This was a teaching on the Lord's Supper, but the principal application is so true to your everyday walk and trying to straddle the fence, kind of like old Ahab did over in the Old Testament. One day he was for wickedness, and on the other hand, he is for God. That never works out. That never works out for walking with Christ. It never does. And here's the same principle. For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Could I submit this morning by way of teaching? People do not grow in the grace of God. We teach it. We preach it. We try to live it and walk it. But others, God never infringes upon your will. He puts it out there. It's a free will lesson. If you reject the lesson and say, well, I'm just not going to go and get in on that new memberships class. I'm just not going to be a part of that revival meeting they're having down there. I'm not going to come on Wednesday night when the pastor's teaching the Word of God, because I'd rather be there in Sunday morning and hear the singing and feel all that's going on there and be around all those people. Guess what? You're weak in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what he says. And it's your choice. It's the people make the choice on their own. Now watch, he says, for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. True context and doctrinal form here is they were eating unworthily the Lord's Supper, and they were dying. Christian people were dying as a result of that thing because they were going against the Word of God, actually committing an abomination, because they were saying one thing, trying to do the religious and right thing, but actually living another way. And isn't that the hypocrisy of Christianity today? People say, oh, how I love Jesus, the whole time loving the world more. That won't fly, and you won't grow in grace, and there'll be no harmony from you and those that believe like that with the men of God and people of God that want to do the things of God. There'll always be that opposition. So here, grace in the Bible is first saving grace. And saving grace is what Paul talked about in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We quote it all the time. But saving grace is what saves a man's soul. And then there's living grace or growing grace. It's one thing to get saved. It's another thing to grow up in the Lord Jesus Christ. Hence our text said, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. To be strong in the grace means more than just getting saved. It means growing in truth, the Word of God, and love. That's the love of the Spirit of God. Acts chapter 20, verse 32 says this, and now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. Now, fathom and comprehend what he's saying. Brethren, saved people, I commend you to God. In other words, this is a spiritual thing. And to the word of his grace. This is a spiritual book and is the key to growing in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the word of God that Peter said we are to be girded up about with. Why? That ye may be strong. And the idea is most folks are not in the book. Most folks are not faithful to hearing the teaching and the preaching of the word of God. Most folks are like the 1 Corinthians chapter 1 people. Some are of Apollos and some are of Cephas and some like this one and some like that one. And Paul rebuked them for that. We have it in our very days, in our very churches. Oh, I'm not going to hear that guy. He's too tall, too short, too fat. Something's always wrong. What is that? That's one that is weak in the grace. He's weak in the faith, and he needs to grow in the Lord Jesus Christ. So here, he says, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up. There it is. It's not us. You know, it's just like falling out with the mail carrier, the mailman, because he brought you a registered letter that says you're being audited by the IRS. Amen. People will fall out with the man of God because he teaches the word of God, and they'll say, well, I don't like how he says it. I don't like what he says it says. I just wish we could forget about the doctrine and just, you know, just have a big old emotional time. Well, it's not about all emotions. Amen. And don't fall out with the mailman because he brings you bad news in the mail. It may be good news, and you haven't figured that out yet. In the Word of God, in the case of the Word of God, it's always good news. So I commend you to God and to the Word of His grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Brother, look. There's a great cloud of witnesses that compass us about today and look upon our actions and our deeds according to the book of Hebrews. And I want to be pleasing not only in their sight, but in the sight of the Savior that saved me. And it's by the grace of God we do that. Paul told the Roman people in Romans chapter 5 and verse 2, by whom also we have access by faith. I want you to get this, if you don't get anything else, because you're going to go away saying, well, how do I get grace? How do I grow in grace? Watch it. He told the Romans, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. I rejoice today because the grace that I'm strengthened by comes through the faith of the Word of God, and the faith and grace go hand in hand, as I said earlier in the lesson. So here, Paul's telling them, strengthen your faith, grow in grace, and become a pillar in your church. Become a strong person in your church for the glory of God. You say, why? That other weaker brothers may come along and may grow up and be strong. You see, the stronger the church is, the stronger you are, the more we can do for the cause of Christ. People say, well, I'm just not a team player. I think sometimes we ought to think about that and be a team player. You say, well, I'd come, but I... Look, because if you don't come and don't be a part, are you hindering some weaker brother that looks at you and says, well, they don't go, so I guess I won't go. And you'll stand and give an account for that thing before God. Watch. To the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Amen. Amen. By the grace of God, and if people aren't much in the presence of God, then they're weak in the grace of God. If you're strong in the grace of God, then you can be something for the glory of God. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. Could I ask this question today? If God saved you by grace through faith, and you're not living for God, was it in vain? Because God didn't save you to pleasure yourself. He didn't save us that we'd go out and do what we want to do. He saved us for his pleasure and for his glory and for his work here yet on earth. But I labor more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Look, we want to manifest the grace of God. God's riches at Christ's expense, and appeal to those that hear the word of God and listen to the teachers here at Hope Baptist Church and preachers here at Hope Baptist Church or any church that's teaching the true word of God, that you might grow in the grace of God. Especially in this age and this time, we need to be strong in the Lord. And finally, one day death's going to come to us all, whether it be by the coronavirus or whether it be by this or that. Death comes to all of us. Peter said this, I believe there's not only saving grace, living or growing grace, but I believe there's dying grace. You're going to have to die. You know what? It'd be kind of sweet to enjoy. Death is just a crossing over, just a passing on, just a graduating to this place called heaven. Peter said this in 1 Peter 5, verse 10, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, and that's a passing. After that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. You see, there's a thing called dying grace. I believe there's been plenty of people get saved, but never grew in grace and never got in church, never become a working part of the body of Christ. They did what they wanted to do, laid out where they wanted to lay, done what they wanted to do, but then death come knocking on their door. And some of them at that day have asked the men of God to come and pray, and they've said things like, I'm really not sure if I'm saved or not. I'm struggling with this. Why did this happen to me? You say, what's wrong? No dying grace. They got saved, but they never lived for God. And now dying comes, and they're not ready to die. Peter said in 1 Peter 1 and 13, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. At the end of our life, there's a grace to be brought to us. Look, I guess my lesson is, are you saved by grace today? And secondly, not only are you saved, are you growing in grace today? Or should I say, could you grow a little more in grace today, as we all could? And lastly, when death comes knocking, will you have the dying grace that it takes to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord? As Paul said, he was ready to die. He was ready to step out. I thank you for listening to the Sunday school lesson today out of 2 Timothy chapter 2. And we didn't get too far, but I wanted to cover this great and wonderful topic of the grace of God. I'm going to close out with a word of prayer, and our services will continue. We'll do some singing. and give our announcements again, and then will be some preaching. Pastor Holt will bring a message here in our open air setting. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for a chance to teach your word. And Lord, may we do our part in edifying the body of Christ. I realize that you can't make anybody learn anything. You can't teach anybody something that they if they're not teachable. So I pray for our people and people that may listen, that they may be guided by your precious Holy Spirit, who is the true teacher and the true guide and the true comforter and the true love. It's in Jesus' name I pray and ask all these things. Amen.